Do sit down, Sergeant. Socks are so much better absorbed with the knees bent.
Hello and welcome back for another episode of For Your Consideration, the podcast featuring roundtable discussions reevaluating the cinematic canon of past masterpieces and modern classics. I'm Mike Josick.
And I'm Dustin Friesenab.
Thanks for joining us. So the movie we selected for this week is 1973's The Wicker Man.
Which is also known as that movie with the barley rigs and the corn rigs and the protective serpent ejaculate and the jars of foreskins, apparently.
Pickled foreskins.
Pickled foreskins.
And aren't they bonnie? So we're here now on our 12th episode, and we were hoping to talk about a couple things before we get into the film commentary segment of the show. First thing we wanted to bring up was polls. We started posting polls on our Twitter and Facebook page, where you, the listener, can go on and actually vote on whether you think one of the films we've covered is a classic or not.
Whether or not we're just a bunch of idiots here who don't know what we're talking about.
I'm probably going to be going back and posting polls for all the past episodes as well. But we encourage you to go on and throw in your vote. Yes or no, do you think this film is a classic? We will be taking listener response, and on a future episode, we'll be mentioning where the audience lies in comparison to where we lie with our judgment. So,
and also we'll bring up any sort of messages that we might get throughout those shout outs. If somebody happens to have something really good that we didn't think about in an episode, we'd bring that up and add that to the conversation.
So we encourage you to go to our Twitter at FYC Show or our Facebook page for your consideration on Facebook and vote on the poll. The other thing I wanted to mention was for any listeners who get the show off of iTunes, while you're there downloading the show, really we would encourage you to rate the show, if possible, review the show. Ratings from listeners is what gets podcasts' attention. It's what puts us in the rankings, spreads the word. It's really helpful to us. Doesn't take a lot of your time.
Otherwise, we get relegated to the bottom of the list and just sort of fade into obscurity and the conversation ends.
And obviously, 5-star review is the best. If you feel comfortable giving us the 5, go for it. But we want you to be honest, so rate us how you see fit. And if you give us a review, that's awesome. And we will likely read any reviews that we get off of iTunes or really any comments off of any social media on the show and give you a shout out.
Another thing that we were hoping to mention was just the simple definition of what is a classic, because we've had conversations with others before where when we're talking about a classic, this movie is a classic sort of de facto. It was so important in the history of filmmaking, and it was the first animated film, let's say, for Snow White, that it's important, it's a classic, just because of those sort of qualities.
I've had to explain to a couple of people that our use of the word classic is more of a shorthand than anything else. There are films that we would very comfortably call classics, but kind of what we're looking at these lists, the top 100 films, these are supposed to be the greatest films of all time. They're up on a pedestal. They're supposed to be the pinnacle of filmmaking for all of these countries. We both voted The Graduate as a no, but we both really liked the film The Graduate. It's not that we don't think that movie is a classic. We both recognize its cultural significance, the time that it came out.
I'd say he's speaking for himself. I don't recognize The Graduate as anything super special.
But whether it should be classified as one of the greatest films of all time, that's where we came down and said no. So a lot of times when this conversation comes up and somebody will say, you said this film isn't a classic, just wanted to...
Is it a movie that is fantastic and will be fantastic forever sort of deal? That's what we're going for. Is it a masterpiece? Is it...
I hope nobody's using The Sixth Sense as a benchmark to try and hit.
A benchmark to try and go over, at the very least.
I like the way you think, Dustin. I can live with that. All right, so I'm probably going to come up with something in text put it up on a website somewhere, either on Facebook or on the show page at fycshow.libsyn.com, and just kind of, I guess, kind of state the mission statement in a way, just because not everybody is probably going to hear this.
And it's hard to just come up with a single word that isn't so nebulous, that isn't, that is properly defining what it is that we're going for. It's
maybe super classic. All right, so without further ado, let's get into the credits and then we'll do the film commentary. The film was directed by Robin Hardy. It was produced by Peter Snell, written by Anthony Schaffer. It was based on the novel Ritual by David Pinner. It starred Edward Woodward, Britt Eklund, Diane Salento, Ingrid Pitt, and Christopher Lee. The music was by Paul Giovanni. Cinematography by Harry Waxman. It was edited by Eric Boyd Perkins, distributed by British Lion Films, and was released in December 1973. Another great Christmas release. The film is generally well regarded by critics and fans. It has been called the Citizen Kane of horror movies.
Which I think is a little insulting to this movie, because Citizen Kane, I don't think, was exactly the Citizen Kane of whatever the thing it is.
The film rates 96 on the BFI Top 100 British Movies of All Time. And that leads us into Dustin. What did you think of The Wicker Man?
The first time I saw this movie was because I usually go into a bunch of movies that have been re-released or redone, and I watch them back-to-back, which people consider crazy. I saw this back-to-back with the ever-so-well-known Nicolas Cage, Not the Bees version. And apparently the voice shifts just shocked Mike a little bit here.
No, it's the Bees.
Not the Bees!
I haven't seen the remake, but...
Either way, I see these remakes, and it's amazing how often they mess it up. And I actually really enjoyed this one. I thought maybe that the remake of The Wicker Man was also sort of, or was based off of a stupid movie, but I enjoyed this one when I first saw it, and this time around, I enjoyed it again. It starts off kind of awkward and weird.
Kind of awkward.
And I was like, man, why do I remember enjoying this movie? But it picks itself up back at the end. I think the scene with Christopher Lee is the turning point.
It is. I would agree. I would agree. I think kind of awkward. What's the opposite of hyperbolic? Understatement?
Understatement?
Kind of awkward is an understatement with this film, particularly that first, like, 25 minutes.
But at least the police constable, he's feeling awkward, too. He's around like, what are all you people on?
I'll give you that. Edward Woodward... I did get a little bit tired of just how uptight and stodgy and proper he was by about three quarters of the way through the movie. But I think because of just how absolutely bizarre this movie is right off the cuff, I kind of appreciated having him being that stoic and solid. And because I was that character, I would have probably reacted the same way.
And to be fair, like, he was specifically chosen movie context wise because he was that stuffy, uptight kind of guy. And he's doing his best to be professional, but at the same time, he's just one guy in there supposed to do a job, and that's more important than all these people running around naked and jumping through fires, because otherwise, your clothes are going to catch on fire.
I will qualify that by film's end, I genuinely like this movie. I would watch it again. I'm probably going to go home, throw it on, and check out the audio commentary, because that's my jam. It's what I do. But the beginning with the singing and...
The repetition of the... And corn rows. The corn rigs. Rose and corn... Or, yeah, corn rigs.
We talked in the graduate episode, we talked about the use of Scarborough Fair and how it was just played over and over and over. And it seemed like corn rigs was the traveling song. Anytime he was moving from building to building or from plane to shore or from mainland to island... They were playing corn rigs.
In the first 10 minutes, they had it about three times. Then they dropped it. And the thing is, they had so many songs in this movie. It's damn near a musical.
Actually, I was going to bring that up because I did a little bit of reading on it. And apparently, like halfway through filming, the director actually announced to the cast that they were filming a musical, much to their surprise. And honestly, I think this probably classifies as the first horror musical. Because, I mean, now there's like...
When was The Little Shop of Horrors released?
The film was...
80s? Yeah, 80s, I think.
Well, the Frank Oz film was in the 80s. I'm not sure when the one with the Roger Corman one with Jack Nicholson. I'd have to look that one up.
Either way.
But, I mean, now you've got things like... what's it called? Repo?
You got Repo, which is a horror opera. Then you've got The Demon Barber of Seville. Whatever.
Fleet Street.
What?
Demon Barber of Fleet Street. Sweeney Todd.
Sweeney Todd. You got Sweeney Todd.
Yeah, there's a few out there. There's not like a whole ton of them, but I don't think... I think this movie has to be considered a musical.
The reason I wouldn't consider it a musical is because the songs are there. They present how the populace lives, but it's not moving forward the plot. They're not singing it.
What about Britt Eklund's song when she's trying to seduce the constable?
That is pretty much the one exception. And also the most out-of-place song, because she's staring at the camera for a lot of it.
Yeah, that is really weird. She's kind of breaking the fourth wall.
Almost like she's daring you not to look at her tits.
Actually, well, okay, yeah. Anything that was like waist or bust up, apparently, was Britt Eklund. But she was like 3 months pregnant doing that scene, so they had a body
really?
Double. They had a body double do everything else. And I guess at some point, even Britt Eklund, like, she saw the scene and she was just like, what the hell? That's you chose that as my body double? Like, that's horrible.
I thought it seemed weird when she suddenly changed to a 300-pound black woman.
Well, isn't transformation and transmogrification a major theme of this?
This is true.
There
this is true.
Now, I feel like we're kind of jumping around a bit here, but I think that's probably appropriate considering the film that we just watched. But bringing up that Britt Eklund musical bit, actually bringing up any of the musical bits, it really kind of brings attention to the sound design of this movie, which is appalling. Absolutely appalling. It's so uneven. Sometimes they're using onset sound. Sometimes it's dubbed. And it's so inconsistent and it's so poorly done. It actually... I think anything that I would look at this movie and dislike, some of the handheld camera shots, difference in film stock, some of the cinematography, the sound mixing, mostly technical, only a few artistic things took me out of this movie.
I definitely agree with some of the sloppy editing, especially the one shot later on when you have the procession. You have a bunch of girls walk by, then it's clear shot, and you can see the cut. And I don't know why they did that instead of having, okay, now here's the procession of guys. There was no reason to have the cut, just have them follow. Like, why is this an impossibility? What was wrong?
It might have been easier to control the shot just by splitting it up, and they probably figured, oh, we'll just splice it together and everything.
It's not like it's a windy day outside and people will notice the splice.
Apparently during filming they did deal with a lot of really bad weather. I guess the actual like behind the scenes making of this film was cursed. It's supposedly a miracle that it even got completed and came out.
You mean there's bad weather in a country that's noted for it raining 50% of the time?
Only 50%? There you go with the understatement again.
To be fair, I haven't been yet. But you were saying that the sound direction was bad. The funny thing is, I don't generally like musicals. I find music takes me out. But here, I actually enjoyed the music. Even though it didn't advance the plot or anything, it really helped set the tone for me. And it might be that it's a lot of sort of a Highlands, Celtic, sort of folksy, but British folksy music. And I enjoyed it.
There were three musical bits that I enjoyed. One of them was, as weird as it was, the song and dance around the maypole outside the schoolhouse, because it actually had a narrative purpose. And then Britt Eklund's song in the room trying to seduce Edward Woodward's character.
I enjoy that song, but I found the scene to be odd.
Yeah, I meant the songs.
Yeah, okay.
And also the final song, just because of how it's used in the scene. And you had commented while we were watching it that there was that juxtaposition of Edward Woodward's character plaintively calling to his God for salvation and not getting it. And then there was this celebratory song going on outside, which looked really bizarre because of how happy and the swinging arms and stuff. But from a storytelling and just kind of audio perspective, like I did enjoy that. So there were three bits where I wasn't hating on any of the music, whereas I thought there was a lot of really weird points kind of around and in between those bits.
It was certainly definitely a lot of filler music. But I enjoyed the music itself. I think that would certainly be something that could be very divisive, however. If you don't, that's my big problem with a lot of musicals. If you don't enjoy the song, that's two things for you to not like. Either the story of the movie or the song. You could be like, I love this movie, but the music, ah. Or I love this music, but the movie, ah.
I do remember when editing the Goodfellas episode, we were talking about the use of music in that movie because it's so pervasive. And I remember very specifically when we asked you what you thought, you were like, I don't know. I don't really pay attention to the music. It takes me out of the movie. So,
to me, sometimes a really good soundtrack is one that I don't notice. I either don't notice the absence or I don't notice the inclusion. Or sorry, if I notice a soundtrack, it'll usually be because I notice the absence or I notice the inclusion, and then I usually have the problem. If it's sort of something that's affecting my mood behind the scenes, that's usually optimal. Or if I just happen to notice it and love it. But that tends to be more on the rare scale for me.
Now, story-wise, I genuinely like where this movie is going. I like the whole Christianity versus paganism, the anti-establishment nature of it, the weirdness of it, the mystery, the twist. I thought...
The Christopher Lee.
Actually, I think that talking about that Christopher Lee scene where he gets introduced, that's going to be a separate conversation all its own. But I do think... If executed a little bit better, and I know a lot of people love this movie, and I know this probably, if anybody is listening to this episode, probably 50% of the people are like, I hate you. But if the execution was better, I think this story would have really, really hammered it home. If there was a little bit more of the creep factor, if there was a little bit more, if you felt a little more of the conspiracy.
I can say that... When they redid it with Nick Cage, they didn't exactly improve upon it. So that's one way you could change it that wouldn't work. One of the big problems there was that they liked to... they made it a whole big family thing where Nicolas Cage's past was a whole big issue in the movie. Here they did it right where the constable was... He was chosen specifically for who he was, but his individual story was far less important. It was the town story, and that was what was driving the movie.
Yeah, you really don't get any backstory for Howie.
The only thing you learn is that he's engaged to be married, and he wasn't going to cheat on his wife. That's pretty much it. There's that, and he's a sergeant, I believe.
Sergeant Howie, yeah. He's very two-dimensional, but at no point is that a problem. Because he is his values. What they want him for... is who he is, and that's, I think, portrayed very well by Edward Woodward. I don't know if I'm just talking out of my ass right now.
No, I'd agree. I would agree entirely. He doesn't flip-flop. He sort of has the bit of the temptation that he does his best to pray away, which is exactly what his character would do. The film starts off with a church sermon, actually, to sort of get you right into the...
That's right.
Religion is a major theme of this movie. It lets you know right as the credits are rolling before he flies into the island.
It actually, you mentioned the flip-flop. That was something that surprised me. I thought for sure, especially being a 70s movie, I thought for sure there was going to be like a sex scene with Britt Eklund and Edward Woodward, that character would flip-flop. And it isn't until later that you really realize how important it was that he didn't, because he had to be a virgin.
It was entirely a test for them to make sure that this guy was exactly who he was supposed to be. Because otherwise, the sacrifice wouldn't have as much of value.
That also brings to mind probably my most loathed scene in the whole film, which was he leaves the Green Man Inn, and he's walking down the path, and there's this really awkward scene of these people fornicating on the lawn. And
a naked woman crying at a, or watering a grave, and
those I didn't mind because that just
but
really,
the thing is
that amplified the weirdness of the situation. But the way the people were arranged on the lawn, the way that it was
shot, basically a show for him.
It kind of was, but from a filmmaking storytelling standpoint, like it was lit terribly, it was shot terribly, it was edited terribly. And
it seems like it didn't belong
exactly.
In the slightest. And then he sort of walks back in without even commenting on it.
Exactly. Oh, no, well, he does come in and he's angry.
He just sort of pushes a guy out of the way and he's like, I'm done with this. I'm going to bed.
So I do wonder, because we were watching the director's cut. We weren't watching the 87-minute cut that was released in theaters back in 73. Although that does bring up a good question, if when we're doing this, we should be watching the actual theatrical cuts, because that's kind of what's being entered on these lists. But that's a question for another time. So anyways, that scene may have been added in. I'm going to do a little research and find out. But that might be the reason for some of the awkwardness of that scene. He may have walked out. He may have seen the watering the graves. He may have seen the naked woman by the tombstone and walked back in, which would have made more sense. Because he was like 2 feet away from that dude who was fondling the woman, and she's like grinding on top of him, making the funny noises. And then he just kind of keeps walking. Like,
where is he even walking to at that point? It seems odd.
I think he just went for a morning stroll after his shitty dinner.
Actually, I really do, now that you mentioned that, I did really enjoy the fact that he brought up, like, why do you have all this canned food here? You guys are known for your fruits and veggies. Like, what the hell is even going on? I thought that was actually a very nicely sort of put in there in the conversation.
There are a lot of clues. From the very beginning, there are a lot of clues that are kind of peppered throughout that you don't really realize are there until you kind of get really far into the film and start to understand what's going on.
I saw the film before and I was sort of getting reminded, and I still needed a little bit, but the clues definitely very helpful and very well put in. It wasn't so overt that it really ruined anything. It definitely added.
Just looking at the time here, I think we should probably talk about Christopher Lee's scene, which we both, I think, want to talk about a little bit. And then we'll get to the judgment segment and start to wrap things up. So, Christopher Lee, in the room the whole time.
And the thing is, like, his conversation style there, it's so sarcastic and it's so different from everybody else in the town up to that point. Because everybody's like, yeah, we don't know the girl. We don't know what's going on. I don't know. Nobody really wants to talk to him. But Christopher Lee, he's out in the open. He's right out there. Just sort of smiles and everything and just joking around.
I just love how he gets brought into that scene and he's walking through that parlor and looking at things. And then he's looking out the window as he came to the... Is it a castle? Is it a manse? I don't know. As he comes to the home of Lord Summerisle, he passes a bunch of young women who are dancing naked around a fire. And he's glancing at them through the window from a distance and just being kind of shocked and appalled. And then all of a sudden, Christopher Lee just gets up out of a chair and he's like, hey, how you doing? It's like one of the greatest film entrances I've seen, probably like in the history of cinema. And he's just got such a way about him. There's so much comedy and creepiness and oddity in that scene. And he's so genuine and he's so attentive and honest.
And you can feel that he's in charge. This is the man to go to. He knows what's going on. He is in charge.
When Howie asks him, like, we need to exhume the body. He's been getting so much trouble from everyone in this town. We need to exhume the body. And he's like, yeah, of course. I see where you're coming from.
Oh, sure. Absolutely. Like, you're a constable. You got to do it. And then after the scene, he's like, I came here and I was asking you to exhume the body. He's like, I was under the impression that I already had given you permission.
And from what I've read about this film, Christopher Lee was looking, because of all of his Hammer roles, he was looking for something a little different, something to show a little more range, do something a little more fun. So I think he was just really, like, chewing the scenery and the dialogue in this movie. He had something to do with getting this film off the ground. So this was like a passion project for him. And you can kind of tell, like, he really owns this movie, him and Woodward. And also, he's so loosey-goosey, friendly, hippie, hey, I'm going to wear my ruffles and play piano, and I'm going to give you everything you want. Yeah, no problem. And Woodward is so uptight and angry and repressed, and it's a really great yin and yang kind of dynamic, and I did really enjoy kind of how it played out. And there is that battle. One of the ideas in the film, whether stated or unstated, is ultimately both gods fail. The Christian God fails and the pagan God fails because their crops failed.
Well, their crops failed the year before. They don't show what happens the year after. In theory,
I guess you could make that argument. It has been a really, really long time. Maybe the pagan gods were just like, God, it's kind of time your credit is up. We need another deposit.
All the minerals could be out of the ground, and they were probably doing the animal sacrifices beforehand, but now it's pretty much what happens the next year. Will they have to sacrifice Lord Summerisle? Like,
he did say it was 18. I think he said 1864 when.
Yeah, so it's been about 100 years
when his grandfather founded the place. So,
from what I understand about agriculture, you have to rotate your crops every 4 years or so. I'm guessing these guys would know that, but I don't know if the writer of the book knew that or if I have correct information.
I believe the book. the book Ritual is, the film is only loosely based on it. It was difficult to adapt, and I think they just took kind of the skeleton of the book, of the story, and sort of built their own story around it. But that's neither here nor there.
And it ended up sort of feeling a lot like a lot of those sort of ritual, here's a agricultural town in the middle of nowhere with a bunch of hicks that have sacrificial rites. You have children of the corn, you have this, you have anyone with a witch coven that's sort of secretly operating behind the scenes.
Oh, witch covens.
Witch covens. And because it's the 70s, you have just tits everywhere.
I think that's, I remember watching it and thinking, because this movie is so influential and so many people do love it and consider it the Citizen Kane of horror films, I think part of that was the anti-establishment nature of it coming out in 73 and just being really kind of in your face against Christianity. But there's also a lot of tits and ass in this movie. So if you're a teenage boy watching a horror movie, this thing is probably, it's one of those VHS tapes with the lines, the tracking lines, because you've rewound it so many times.
Especially that scene with the good old body double.
And that's not to take away from the story or the film or the themes or...
It wasn't done gratuitously. It's more supposed to be, this is liberated free people. This is where they're not so concerned about it. It's not shoved in your face to try and arouse.
It was,
it's
narratively
just there.
Yeah. There was a context. And it fit within the context. Still, in the 70s and 80s, you're a teenage boy. You don't have the internet. Anyways, I think we should probably cut off the commentary there and get into the judgment segment. So, again, Dustin, I leave it to you first.
At the end of the day, this is a good movie. I would certainly recommend it to a number of people. But it doesn't have a universal acclaim feel to it, to me. It has a definitely a good ending, and I enjoyed a lot of the acting, but certainly had a sloppy editing, some of the weird sound issues, and like that's all fairly forgivable. Like, it doesn't mean you can't be a cinematic masterpiece or anything like that, but the first half of the movie was very jumbled and didn't quite fit with the rest of it. And it's, this one is actually a bit of a hard one for me to say whether it is or is not a classic. And with a lot of movies
it's
that are
nice
supposed
to see
to be
you
scary,
on the fence for a change.
With a lot of movies that are supposed to be scary, I think I'm going to feel sort of like this, because there is a reason that horror movies don't tend to make it there, and I think it's usually the emotional reaction that they're sort of lacking. And I could certainly see this movie turning off a lot of people with the music. I enjoy this kind of music, so it definitely wins me over a whole lot with it, but actually, you know what? I started off, I was going to say not a classic, but I think I am going to actually say it barely fits. It fits in there. It barely squeaks in.
I'm going to counter your argument. I do think this movie is good. I enjoyed it. I would consider it a classic, possibly more a cult classic than anything else. I don't think I'd call it the Citizen Kane of horror. There's a lot of horror movies out there that I think are far superior to this.
I'd call this more of a suspense mystery, personally. Like,
it's been called a folk horror as well. But yeah, I just... Greatest film of all time, even greatest British films of all time. I just find it really hard to wrap my head around that. Just grab onto it and go, yeah. So I'm not really on the fence about it. I don't really need to talk about it. You've heard my problems. Technically, artistically, earlier in the commentary. So yeah, I'm gonna say no.
Well, then we'll just have to agree to mostly disagree.
I will say though, it brings me great amount of pleasure to see you so torn, because at the end I'm usually the one who's like, okay, we need to take a break, we need to order a pizza.
I need to think about this for 2.5 hours, just pace back and forth throughout the room wearing a hole in my floor.
So that brings us to the close of another episode of For Your Consideration. We have The Wicker Man with one yay and one nay. It is a split decision. Let us know what you think. Visit the polls. We will be posting them on Twitter and Facebook. Do you think The Wicker Man is a classic? Yes or no?
What does the tiebreaker say?
We will take listener response and we will bring it up on a future show. Other ways you can join the conversation, go to iTunes. If you're downloading the show from iTunes anyway, rate and review us. Can't stress that enough. We want your ratings. We want to hear what you have to say about us and the show. You can also go to the show page at fycshow.libsyn.com. You can listen to the show streaming there. You can download it, and you can also leave comments. We're on Twitter. Our handle there is at FYC Show. We will often do live tweets, not only when we're pre-watching the episode before our records, but also just randomly if we're watching a show, we'll throw our thoughts out there. Kind of a fun time. We're also FYC Show on Instagram, posting pics there. Follow us, check us out. And you can also send us an email, text, audio, video, whatever you have, any way you want to comment, any way you want to send us what your thoughts are. You can also send us an email at fycshowmail@gmail.com. Send us text, voice, video. It's all good. Let us know what you think.
And if you've got some good comments that we completely managed to miss in our review of the movie, we might bring it up in a future episode or bring it up online and continue the discussion somewhere else.
We've also talked about, depending on the number of comments that we get, possibly doing a listener mail section. We have no idea if that's viable right now, but that's kind of all up to you guys. The more you send in, the more we have to work with. So that's all the social media that you can find us on. Interact, have fun, join the conversation.
And check out these movies.
So that's it for us. Thanks for joining us. It was fun dipping into the British Film Institute's list for a change. I'm sure we will do it again.
And if you have any recommendations for us for any masterpieces, critically acclaimed movies from around the world, feel free to shoot us a recommendation.
And that's a wrap. I'm Mike.
And I'm Dustin.
See you next time.
Peace.